Yeah, we just had our truth meeting. The schedule is a little different today with it obviously being Labor Day, and so we're trying to get through practice and meetings a bit earlier today to try to gain some extra rest and maybe some extra game planning today so that we can – this week's a little different, so we're trying to get a jump start. But I'll share with you what I shared with them on the truth of the game. I thought our special teams, the positives were we started really fast. I think we had 131 return yards in the first quarter, which was pretty awesome. Average first half starting field position was the plus 35 and the plus 48 for the whole game, so that's really good. The effort was incredible in the first half. Thought the negatives on the special teams were we didn't finish the same way that we started. Had a few loafs and six missed tackles in the second half. Punt was just average. Punt coverage was just average. Defensively, I thought 1 of 11 on third and fourth downs. Those are critical downs, and that's a great percentage. They created 13 negative plays, 2 turnovers, and had 0 penalties on defense. Thought that was really nice. The big glaring negative that we got by with in this game, but we will not get by with in future games, is alignment and assignment, and that's frustrating to me. But we had numerous snaps, probably 15, I think it was, that we're not lined up properly, and it's gonna bite us big time if that continues to be the issue. So we did have a lot of young kids out there, but nobody is gonna write that, and it's not gonna make you feel better sitting in the film room after a week that it bites you. If it's one thing if somebody makes us miss a tackle or like this back this week will. That's one thing, but for us to be aligned improperly and be a gap short or not be on the same page with all 11 on the back end, especially, that it will burn you. And that was outside of that, I thought our kids played hard after the first drive, and I thought they created negative plays, and obviously the turnovers, one for a score, was huge. But we cannot continue to not be on the same page. Offensively, 7.6 yards a carry, which is great. I thought our tempo was good. 11 explosive plays, no turnovers, 6 of 10 for third down, 100% in the red zone. So there's a lot of good things offensively. I think the biggest negative is our perimeter blocking and still the understanding of our routes. We don't understand landmarks and spacing really, really well. And our quarterback decision-making needs to be 100% or at least high 90s. And we had 3 bad decisions. But the biggest truth of the day is we're 1-0. And we defended our home, and we celebrate that. But certainly there's a lot that we can improve on as we look forward to Cal. Cal is gosh, they're talented. Wilcox is a great defensive mind. They're very sound on that side. Not flashy, but sound. And he does a really nice job there. And then offensively, they're extremely scary. That tailback he's one of the best ones I've seen. And obviously, they had 670 yards, I think it was, last week. And go fast. They got about 100 plays in the game and had 8 receivers with 2 or more catches. And, so the starting quarterback went out. The other kid came in and still threw for all these yards. So they've got depth, and I think the tailback is really, really special. And it will be a great challenge for us as we go on the road to Cal.
When you talked about going on the road to Cal, how much of a challenge is that when you go across the country? How much experience have you had in doing that with a team before?
The only experience I had was BYU, which we were from the East Coast, so that was a long trip. But You know, I told our team when I taught my lesson for the week this morning with them, and that's one of the challenges I have for me is to embrace it because I don't like it. I don't like scheduling teams on the West Coast. I just soon play somebody over here on the East Coast, but it was done. And so me complaining or not embracing it is not the proper response. And so the only one I've done is BYU. It was a challenge, and this one is even further and another time zone. I think it creates some challenges, but this will be a good test for all of us, coaches, training staff, nutritionists, strength staff, support staff, players. How do we handle, you know, if things are a little uncomfortable or it's not exactly the way we want it? And I'm speaking to myself as much as anyone. And you've got to play a really good football team. And at their place, when our body times are 9:30 or 10 at night and we're kicking it off. And so all of that's going to be a challenge, but you know what? That's what life is. And so how we approach it and the attitude we have for the opportunity we have, it ought to be one of gratitude and thankfulness. And we got to suck it up and fly a long flight, and that's what we got to do. And we get another opportunity to represent this school, our conference, and each other. And so let's go make the most of it.
Hugh, with you guys, so many different offensive linemen getting in the game even before it was kind of out of hand. Do you and Jake have a sort of a timeline? Do you want to settle on a five early in the season, or are you comfortable continuing that rotation?
I think if we continue to push the boundaries and go fast, I think we're really comfortable with 8 to 9 guys. I don't know that we would go any beyond that if the game is still in question, but I don't think there's a, you know, you have the five that rolled out there the first series. I don't like calling them, y'all already know I don't like calling them our first team, but they rolled out there the first series. And then I think the second series, Jeremiah was out there, and I don't know when Tate showed up or Connor or, but, you know, we played those eight pretty dang quick, I think. And so, you know, I think you got to keep them fresh. And you know, maybe some weeks that it's better that Jeremiah rolls out there the first series, depending on what kind of front you're playing. He's got more girth to him, obviously. But really the reason we did what we did this past week was because of all the chaotic looks. And Gunner has a really, really sharp IQ. And we felt like he and Dylan and Stutz beside Tutal was a really good combination so that the chances of us giving up negative plays against the Don Brown different looks, I thought were lessened by having Gunner on one side and Cam on one side. And that's the reason that's who rolled out there the first series.
You talked a lot about the wide receivers in the fall. How did you feel like they did in their first game, especially getting to hook up with some big plays downfield with Peyton?
Yeah, I mean, they made some plays. We really stopped throwing it down the field, you know, pretty early in the third quarter probably. We missed an opportunity early with Jay Fair, but it was really something that we've never covered. We went fast and they didn't guard him, you know, and I think he was uncertain what to do and Peyton was uncertain what to do. And we were all kind of like, we haven't covered that, you know. So that was a little bit on us too, is what happens if they don't cover you? Should you just stop and throw in the ball? Or that didn't happen often. So that was really the only one I thought we missed. We don't totally understand the spacing and landmarks and energy that routes need to be ran with, when particularly when you think you're not getting it. But it has a vital part of the concept. And we're still struggling a little bit there. We're better, but we've got to continue to improve that. It's good to see you, Malcolm. Thought he really looked Malcolm's fast. He's one of the faster guys on our team. So if he comes, you know, he's been hurt all fall camp. If he comes on, I think that gives us even more capability of deep threats.
You've talked in the past about the how you and Phillip are going to balance play calling. Now that you're a game in, how did that balance work? How'd you feel with that being comfortable or not comfortable, yeah, that whole process?
Well, it was easy Saturday. It wasn't, I mean, you know, you just kind of looked at the call sheet and the things we had planned are the things we called, and they tended to work in the run game, and so that makes it, it's not real, you know, I don't think that was a great test for us. Truthfully, because the run game was working and you felt you had control of it, and really it was just me every now and then saying, hey, let me see us 7-man protect, let me see us 5-man protect. It wasn't it was smooth. I think as the games get more challenging will be, you know, how do we operate then? And but I have no worries. I mean, neither one of us have any ego about it. So let's figure out what we can do to help our team win.
Hey, Hugh, can we expect Jarquez back this week?
You know, we've got the availability of a lot of players is up in the air. So, I'd rather not even comment on all of them. I mean, we got a long list from Nick Mardner to Austin Keys to Jalen to Pritchett to all of those guys are just kind of hopefully can have a good week, and we could really, really use some of those guys.
Coach, how does it feel to finally get through week one for you, your coaching staff, the team as a whole? You get through the stresses of the very first game of the season. Now you obviously have to take a tough road trip. But what's the feeling around your team and your program now that you finally get through that first week?
We want to know, but it's in the trash and over with. And that's kind of the way you approach this profession. I did think a compliment to our coaches, strength staff. I thought, you know, our kids, now they didn't probably have to strain for four quarters like they will in future games. But I thought we, for our first game, we were really clean. There weren't any, we had zero penalties of zero penalties of like pre-snap. We had none of those. I mean, we had a couple holding calls and then the kick out of bounds. But I mean, when you play the first game, you only have that few of penalties. I just thought we were prepared. And so I compliment our coaches on that. And good to have it behind us. Good I said in the post game, our fans are incredible. Our student section is incredible. Our band, cheerleaders, everybody. The Tiger Walk was awesome. Being with family was great. But that one's over. It's 1-0, and now we got a tough test on the road.
Coach, you mentioned in your opening statement where you would like the quarterbacks to grade out. After watching the tape, how big is the gap between where you see they are and where you would like them to be going into Cal?
Well, Robbie didn't have to make many decisions. So, but boy, was he's really talented and vital to our success. He will have to make some in the future. The Peyton just, he had three decisions that were wrong, and I expect more. I expect him not to make the ones he made, and he knows that. But it played solid. You just would like that decision making to be around 100% on, particularly in the run pass world, where he's deciding whether it's a run or pass. Those need to be near 100%.
You seem to be coaching them pretty hard on the sideline. Is that what that was?
I'm crazy sometimes, but yeah, I get frustrated. I don't lie, and I tell them that. Look, but here's the deal. I'll play the next play with you now. My love for them doesn't change. Their performance has nothing to do with how. I learned this from my father, who's a tough, tough man. But I went through a very difficult stretch, and my father taught me, listen, I love you. And it's not based on your performance. So as long as our players know that I think I can coach them hard, and they see that, and they see a consistency, and hey, he don't treat me any different. You know, after the game, whether I threw the four touchdowns or three picks, you know, yeah, I'm disappointed. Yeah, I feel like I ought to coach you better, and I felt like you ought to played better, but that doesn't affect. And I think Peyton knows that. And the two, there were two things that happened in that same series, and he knew it. And I think when he missed the first one, and I'm yelling and screaming, which I probably need to. I'm figuring out who they are, and they're figuring out who I am. I think when I do that to him, he presses a little bit. And he handed the ball off, and the safety triggered so hard, and the safety made the hit like 1 yard in the backfield. So I'm, how do you not see that? You know, and that ball should be thrown. And so I'm doing with my antics over there, and he probably sees that. And then about two plays later, the darn safety stays as high as he can, and we pull it and throw it. And those are the two things that can happen. And he's too intelligent, has too much of an IQ, and he'll get that cleaned up and fixed. And I've got to make sure I coach him in a way that is helpful and not and doesn't make him press.
Yeah, who did you go into that game thinking Robbie was going to be like your red zone main guy, or did you just kind of go with the hot hand? I mean, because he was extremely electric.
I mean, you saw. I mean, as soon as we got down there, we put him in, so that's on the call sheet. So that's a plan. I mean, it wasn't something that I just said, hey, how about let's try Robbie here? It's planned. So, well, I mean, I don't know. I think every game plan is different. I just think he's super talented, and I think there's a lot of things we can do with him. And I know people are in this world and day and time, you know, you can't play two quarterbacks. And, well, I don't know. Maybe they're right, but we're 1-0. And if we go 2-0 doing it, we'll keep doing it. If it starts to, you know, but I think we need them both. But he was, I mean, you see how talented he is down there. So, sure, it's always going to be a possibility. Now, you got to – you can't be so predictable, but we obviously weren't in game one, and there's not enough tape to get really great data yet on what our tendencies are. So we'll come up with a game plan for Cal. As I've said all along, Robbie will always be a part of our game plan.
Hey, Hugh, you briefly touched on the challenge of playing on the West Coast. As far as scheduling and practice this week, do you want the guys to, like, stay up later? Do you adjust your practice schedule, or like how much thought goes into those adjustments?
I probably hadn't put enough thought into it, truthfully. Our schedules, when they're still college students, and you know, most of ours are in class stuff, so it's really hard to tinker too much with our schedules here. We're going to practice a little earlier Thursday and try to we don't want to get to California until late Thursday night, so that you're not sitting in a hotel at all. Hardly Thursday, it's time to go to bed. Then Friday will be a pretty good challenge to get your bodies adjusted. But we're going to go practice out there at San Mateo Junior College and do it our normal time and try to get back to the hotel like we would on a normal Friday at the same time and try to, you know, treat it as much as normal as we can. The hard day is going to be really Saturday, sitting around, but that's a long time before kickoff.
Back to the quarterbacks, if I may. Obviously, it's not always easy to be in that situation where you both want to be starting and you both want to be in those big moments. But from what we were able to see on the field and what you've seen behind the scenes, how have the guys handled that? And how do you feel like they could, you know, make each other better throughout the rest of the season?
I'm glad you mentioned that, actually, because they're either doing a really good job of faking it or they're getting along pretty well and are buying into, you know, how do we help the team win? And I hope that's the case. I believe it is. You know, I hope that continues.
How are you on the
punt? I do wish they'd quit jumping up and you know, when they jump up together, I don't like that at all. I think both of them could go down with a sprained ankle. You know, I mean, why are we doing that? That makes no sense. But they seem to enjoy it.
They're young. They'll be all right. Yeah. you on the punt return, it looked like it was Eugene Asante who had a chance to make a block down the field, but instead he turned his back and shielded a guy and didn't get the 15-yard penalty. Was that a good teaching moment for your team?
Well, we work hard on it, and there was two of them actually on that play, and then another one where on Sean Jackson's run, Caleb did a similar thing, really busted it to get there and kind of high-screened the guy right at the end. So I think, you know, our staff's done a good job of stressing we need to be penalty. We need to win the turnover battle, and we need to win the penalty battle in as many games as we can. And if you can win time of possession, I think that's good also, and obviously those third and fourth downs. And we won those in this game, the penalty and the turnover and the time of possession. But it's easy for those to be penalties if you're not well coached.
Coach, talk about Jay Fair in the passing game. He earned some hype this offseason, and I think he got the most targets this game. Can you talk about his play and what he did well and what you'd like him to improve on?
Yeah, I think Jay and Var have been the most consistent and solid guys, and I think our outside guys are coming on. But we felt ever since spring that those two guys were going to be main contributors and solid performers, and I've seen nothing that keeps me from thinking that's still true. So proud for both of those guys, and hope we've got to expand their role some. We didn't show a whole lot in the passing game Saturday, truthfully, and hopefully they have more targets coming.
After looking at the tape, how did the defensive front do?
Again, we have our alignment issues, which truthfully that's not on them because that communication comes from the back. We still just don't get off blocks great. And we just got to try to keep improving that. I thought they played hard and thought they most of the time were assignment sound in the right gap, but man, we got to play with our hands and rip off blocks, and we still don't do that quite well enough for me.
You talk about getting away with things in games like Saturday, and a lot of SEC teams had similar games to what you had. How do you keep that from becoming an issue? How do you teach it? Hey, this is fixing to be really different.
Well, I mean, this is great. I think the best teaching can happen after a win because you can be hard on them, hard on your coaches, and you know, our coaches meeting truthfully yesterday wasn't real pleasant, and it wasn't demeaning but it was, guys, here's the facts, this is reality, and this is who we are right now, and thank God we get to celebrate being 1-0 and one in Jordan Hare, and we won't take that lightly, and that's awesome. However, this is what I see. And if that continues, we won't be celebrating a whole lot. I've said, I don't know how great we can be this year. I don't. But we ought to be able to line up right and play hard. And that's what we've got to get fixed. I thought our kids played hard. And I thought it was a clean game. And I thought, but you can't line up wrong 15 times.
You mentioned Cal's tailback in your opening statement. Just what about him and the way they use him is it makes him a special player?
Just hand it to him. They don't have to. I mean, it ain't like they have to create some special deal. Just run inside zone or outside zone or counter with him. And if it's semi-blocked well, he's a handful. He's big. He's strong. He's fast. He's got great vision. He is really, really talented.
Hugh, on the other side of the ball, you talked about how good of a defensive coach Wilcox is. You mentioned last week, of course, the complexities of Don Brown. What are some of the things that make a Wilcox defense difficult to solve in a game?
It's truthfully not that. I mean, I don't mean this. It's not. This is not like last week. We can see everything. you know, but his kids are going to be in the right spot. They're going to be lined up correctly. They're going to play hard. They're going to tackle well. And you're going to have to drive the field and multiple times, and they're going to try not to give you explosive plays, and we've got to try to find a way to find a way to have some. But they're going to be in the right spot. They're just extremely well coached for what they do. It's not a complicated scheme, but they do what they do really, really well. And last week it worked. I mean, they only gave up, 40 yards rushing, I think. Had three picks. Held them to 2 of 11 on third down. So they had a really, really good defensive effort in game one.
All right, Coach. Thank you
for your time. All right, thank y'all. Oh, yeah. You give me 7.5 every time, we'll win a lot of games.
Did y'all recruit the receiver